Who was the great Chiduch? You heard about the Hazonish? The Hazonish didn't have kids. But his nephew, the sister, the daughter of his brother, I believe, okay, had a girl. And they decided to make this type of match. So they told the boy, listen, go and meet the girl. Now to meet the girl, he had to take a train. And it was a long traveling. He says to himself, I'm going to be traveling, I don't know how many
hours
or maybe days. I'm going to miss learning. I'm going to fill up the hours of learning that I'm supposed to travel. And when I travel, I sleep. And he learned that time, instead of 36, 54 hours. In a row. I want to see you 24 hours learning, Habibi. 24 hours in a row. We're making only one night and we are already zombie. Huh? 54 hours. The rabbi got to the train and everything was planned. He's coming to the train, he's going to sleep over in the train, and he's going to have power. He gets to the train. And he realized that something is not going so well. What is it? The chairs of the train was made up of wool. Wool. And there is an issur of wool and linen. It's called sha'atnez. He says, I'm going to be sitting there. I'm going to be enjoying from sha'atnez. As the Pesach wants to say that it's not the same by wearing and sitting. Anyway, Safra said, but minan. And he stand up the whole entire
trip.
Because he didn't want it to, sit down in those chairs. He got to the place, and until the brother of the Kalam comes up to him, tells him, okay, are you ready to meet my sister? He said, no, listen, give me a few minutes, I just, to put a little bit in my head. What can I tell you? Put a little bit, not really, when he was sitting with the girl, he fell down asleep.
Great sign.
Saying to show what's going to be in the future. He was sitting already with the girl, boom, he fell down asleep. Ah, the girl was upset. Listen, which type of boy is that? Already at the beginning, before he fell down asleep, he was talking to him, the guy is not here. The guy is not focused. He's not, no, nothing. And then he falls down asleep in front of her. She went back home. She said, listen, daddy, it's not for me. The Hazonish, I said, was her uncle. The Hazonish heard about the story. He checked out a little bit more. He called up the boy. He started to talk to him. And he realized what happened. He came back to his niece. Thank you. He came back to his niece. And he told her, listen, I want to tell you one thing. Maybe sleep today, but he will be awake. And he will wake up all Am Yisrael for generations. You ready to marry him? You're going to have a greater, one of the Gedolei HaDor of our generation. Now, but I have one decision. Coming up, she's going to choose right or not. And then she decided that she's marrying him. And all of the rest, today, that's one of the most largest families in the world. Mishpachat Kanevsky. You want to know why? Every single kid got married at the age of 18. They have already grandsons. One decision. And I'm going to tell you now another story that is totally different. Chacham Avadei Yosef Rabotai was married to Rabbanit Margalit. You heard the story? The Rabbanit Margalit. Did you know that it was that Rabbanit Margalit wasn't his first shidduch? Not many people know that. Rabbi Avadei Yosef was meeting a girl and things were going well. One day the girl, they made already engagement. One day the girl tells the rabbi, young guy, I would like to go with you to a movie. Now, Rabotai, the movies of before is not the movies of today. There was no issue of tzniot, and not issue of bad words, and not issue of killing and blood and all these type of things. No, no, we're talking about another generation. Come with me to the... And Rabotai, Hamadeh Yosef wasn't holding there. No, it was... And when she realized that he doesn't want to go and he's not into it, she said, no, I never knew that that's my future husband, that he wasn't dedicate all his life only learning. I want him to be a little bit with me also, you know, the head in the ground, you know, to care about my feelings as well. Bekitur, she made a whole movie around it. And she broke the shidduch. And obviously, years later, and I'm talking maybe 40 to 50 years after, one day there is a woman coming up to the office of the rabbi. Hamadeh Yosef was already, you know, a king. She's coming up, and she says, Rabbi, she's telling to one of the shamashim, I would like to speak with the rabbi. He says, listen, the rabbi right now is not accepting anyone. Tell the rabbi that I am his first shidduch, that I would like to see him. The shamash went to Chamodiah, ask him, first shidduch? First time I hear it, first shidduch, there. Yeah, of course, wonder. She came, and she wasn't able to open her mouth. She just started to cry. She says, I had the opportunity in one decision, to be the wife of the Gedol Ador. And only because of one movie, I was able to lose everything. She got a whole tragedy in her life. She never got married, I think. Something like that. Rabotai, the idea goes like this. When a person understands that he have moments of decision, and maybe those moments of decision are one moment for all your life, lifetime. And you're going to decide to do the right thing, you will never know what's the result of this right decision that he took. We spoke yesterday about Yaakov Avinu, and we explained that Yaakov Avinu also had this type of decision. Yaakov Avinu had many types of decisions that made a whole difference. You remember we spoke yesterday about the dream of Yaakov and the Sulam, and we explained that the Malachim, Olim Ve'yoredim, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Yaakov, come up! Don't be scared. Trust in me. And at the level of Yaakov Avinu, he didn't trust 100% on HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and he didn't want up. And said in Midrash, because he didn't want up, what happened? All of those goyim that went up, HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave a decree that all of those goyim will manage and will be on top of Am Yisrael until Mashiach's arrival. One decision, one man, and everything is depending on what are you going to choose. That's in our hands. Just want to finish. We're going to be looking all Sefer Bereshit Rabotai. It's a book of stories from one hand. But from another hand, the stories are coming to teach. Ma'aseh Avot Siman Labanim. Whatever happened with our forefathers is a sign for us how to behave, how to manage our life, how to look forward in all type of things that we're going to have in front of us. By the way, one of the greatest Chachamim used to say that this book that is the most important book of all the five Sefarim of the Torah is Sefer Bereshit. More than Sefer Shemot, we're talking about the giving of the Torah. You know why? Because Musar is above everything. And where are we learning Musar? Ethics? We learn it from the stories of Bereshit. We're going to be reading about Rachel and Leah. We'll be reading how Laban and Rasha exchanged them. And I just want to close up with one point. Rabotai, Chachamim are teaching us that Ve'ane Leah Rakot, the eyes of Leah were mushy. Very watery. And say Chachamim, why Ve'ane Leah Rakot? She had no,
eyelids.
Eyelids. She didn't have it. Why? Because she was crying too much. why she was crying too much. She knew that there is two brothers and there is two sisters. There is Esav and Yaakov and there is Rachel and Leah. And she knew that Rachel, it's made up Mishamayim, the Shiduch for Yaakov Avinu. Why? Because Abechol, Abechora. Because the oldest to the oldest. And the second one to the second one. Esav was the Bechor. And Leah was the Bechora. Yaakov is the second, Rachel is the second. And say Chachamim that Leah didn't want to get married to this Rasha. And she never stopped crying. Even though there is a decree in Shemayim that that's your Shiduch. She didn't stop crying. And the result we all know. Borei Olam did a whole story. At the end of the day, Yaakov Avinu got married first to Leah. Rabotai, we're learning from here one point. Never give up. Doesn't matter what the situation, doesn't matter how dark looks, doesn't matter how terrible can be. If you have hope, if you have emunah, you have bitachon that HaKadosh Baruch Hu managed the world, and you don't give up, you continue praying, Borei Olam is going to show his hand. But the greatest yetzer hara is to see everything dark and to raise our hands. That's it. I cannot do it. There is nothing to do. I remember one story and then with this and finish. There was a rabbi that a guy came up to him and told him, Rabbi, you have a family member, the lo alenu velo alechem. Dots already gave up. Gave up. That's it. There is nothing to do. I'm going to tell you the details of the story. The story goes, they went to Hamed Yashiv. Abel Yashiv. And he told him on Shabbat was Friday night. Rabotai, listen to the story. Friday night, Friday afternoon, 2 hours before Shabbat. And they come, a couple comes to the rabbi and they said, Rabbi, our husband is very sick. The doctors here in Israel are not giving me hope. There is only one maybe of the maybe that... that maybe if he's going to travel to America and he will pass a certain surgery and then the percentage is not so high, etc., etc., maybe he can get safe. Rabbi Eliashiv was a genius. He knew the whole Torah by heart in seconds. All of a sudden, after the question, he sees Rabbi Eliashiv putting his hand in his forehead, thinking for 2 minutes, it's too much. Too much. The room is quiet. I'm sorry, before he did that, he asked the wife, he said, no, I'm sorry, he cannot travel. Chilul Shabbat. And the wife jumped. And the wife said, no, Rabbi, but it's the life of my husband, what's going to be? And then the rabbi put his hand in the forehead. And after 2 minutes, he came with a psak halacha. Right now, call up this doctor. He's going to arrange everything. He's going to take the next flight to America. Mutar. That's what they did. He gave a berakha. They went and everything was successful. They came back, Rabotai, to Rabbi Yashiv, and told him, Rabbi, what happened? The husband came back. And he says, Rabbi, you remember that night? Why you were thinking so much? 2 minutes is a lot. The rabbi said, I'm going to tell you. Because according to the halakha, your situation was the situation that we are not allowed. We are not allowed to do Chilul Shabbat. Why? You told me all the details of the situation. No reason why to do Chilul Shabbat. And I said at the beginning not to go. But then your wife jumped. And she started to scream and to cry. She doesn't want to lose her husband. These 2 minutes, I pass all the shas in my head. To think, if when it's written in the halakha that if the chole, if the sick guy feels that he needs this type of refuah, even if the doctors are saying not to, we give him. Because the sick feels more than what the doctor can feel. That's halakha. I pass through all the shas. What's going to be the halakha if this time whoever feels it is not the husband, is the wife of the husband? We also give the permission or not? And I found few places in the whole Torah where a wife, whatever she feels, is the same feeling of the husband. And therefore, halakha, I said, it's mutar to go to America and to do Chilul Shabbat. Rabotai, one movement of one person, one decision had to give up, to decide to go all the way till the end, and give the salvation.